To start our review of entropy, we're going to look at a few definitional things. So I'm going to start with this definition of the word entropy. I am going to recommend that for general chemistry, you not stress too heavily on this. For those of you that are in my class, I'm happy to talk with you more if you want to email me, or when we're not in quarantine, if you want to come by my office and talk to me, depending on what year you're listening to this in. So the definition that our text used was that a thermodynamic function that increases with the number of energetically equivalent ways to arrange the components of a system to achieve a particular state. So the way I want you to think about this is if a particular arrangement can occur in lots of different combinations, that's going to be high entropy. Whereas if we can only have it in a few combinations, that's going to be low entropy. And this is why I like using the idea of microstates to talk about this. So I've lost my pen. There we go. So with the idea of microstates, we can talk about very simple systems. You can do this with more complex systems, but the numbers get so large, we're not going to be able to calculate it by hand. So if I thought of a system where I had two flasks and they were connected and I had, let's say, three molecules and they could be in either flask one or flask two. So for example, let's say I wanted how many microstates are there where all three molecules are in the first flask? Well, there's only one. There's only one way to arrange three molecules to put all three in flask one. That's provided. So at first it's like, wait, what's a microstate? So let's look at another condition. Let's say I had the connected flasks and I wanted two in the left flask and one in the right. Well, the first is I could have this top and this left one molecule in here, and I could have the right one in flask one. That's one microstate. I can draw another state though. Man, drawing these things is hard. Where I had the top one and the right one, and then I had the left molecule here. So if you think of them like molecules, let's think of them as molecule A, B, and C. So if A and B are in flask two, that's one option. A and C can be in flask one, or in my flasks, we're going to pretend these are the same system that I didn't just change sizes on you. Or we could have molecules B and C, and then A is in flask two. So in this case, there are three microstates that allow you to have two molecules in flask one and one in flask two. Therefore, if we were to compare the two macrostates, so macrostates being just how many molecules are in each, the first example only had one microstate for the macrostate being three molecules in flask one. Whereas in the second case, where we have two in flask one, there are three different states that do that. So there are more microstates that do that. So if I were to compare the entropies, the second condition has more microstates, so has a higher entropy. This is something you will continue to study if you stay with us in the sciences. Physics will cover this in more detail, as will be in later thermodynamics classes. So I think it gets a bit easier as you look at more examples of it, and as you get more sophistication in your mathematics, we can do more with it, and it starts to make sense why we think about this term, whereas I do think in this course sometimes it can feel a little, okay, you told me this, but it doesn't do that much. But I think it's something that as you practice with, you'll get better at. I intentionally don't say entropy is disorder. So that's a little bit misleading, that doesn't necessarily mean you could have a disordered system that is a very particular way to be disordered that would be low entropy. So I don't like that term. It is commonly used, but I try to stay away from that terminology because I don't think it focuses on what we're doing with entropy and can lead to misconceptions. I think it works really well once you understand entropy. You can think of that analogy and it can work with you because you know the ways where it's not exactly disorder. So that's why I don't use that term. If you hear it from someone else, though, it's not a huge deal. It makes sense. There's some reasons why they use that. Moving on. When we talk about entropy as with other thermodynamic quantities, we're usually going to be talking at standard conditions. At the very least, when you look it up in a big table of values, that table of values is going to be for standard conditions. So if you're not at standard conditions, you'll have to adjust. And we'll look at that with some examples later. So for example, if you have a gas, standard conditions are that gas is one atmosphere of pressure. If you have a solution, it's a one molar concentration. And for any phase, it's usually going to be at 25 degrees Celsius. You could state that it was something else inside the table, but most places it's going to be 25 degrees Celsius. Now, what can increase entropy? First, we can look at phase changes. So if you take a substance and it goes from gas to liquid, you're now lowering it because the way I have it listed here, gas is the highest, whereas liquid is going to be in the middle and solid is going to be the lowest. This is because when you're in a solid, it's very rigid. There aren't as many configurations for the molecules because they can't move around a whole lot. Whereas in the liquid, they've got more motion. There are more ways to arrange them and still be the same thing. Whereas in the gas, when they get really spread out, there's a lot of different ways to do that. So as your phase change goes from solid to liquid to gas in terms of what is increasing. So if we were to rewrite this in retrospect, I like this better. Solid is less than liquid is less than gas. So it increases as you go that way. This is increasing entropy. Next, you could increase the number of product molecules in your reaction. So if you had a reaction where you had the molecule A and it was a gas, and it reacted to form two B molecules and they were gases, you would have increasing entropy as you've now split up that molecule and there are now more different arrangements it can take. This third example, ionic solids when they're dissolved. So if I have some solid, I'm going to call it, let's just say NaCl, sodium chloride. If I put that in water, it's going to form Na plus, aqueous, and Cl minus, aqueous. When it goes from the solid arrangement to that ionic compound that's dissociated in water, it's going to increase in its entropy. There's more ways to arrange those. And then finally, if we increase our temperature, the entropy increases. A final note for just sort of concepts, the entropy of the universe is always increasing. What this means is that you can have a chemical reaction that will decrease entropy locally for that system. The only way for that to happen, though, is elsewhere entropy has to increase more to compensate for that. So we can't, the universe will not have decreasing entropy. This is one of those laws we're fairly confident in. Obviously, everything in science has conditions where it can be disproven, but this would cause a very large surprise to many people if we were to ever find a way to disprove this one. We're reasonably as close to certain as we can be that this is really stable. The entropy of the universe always increases. Energy spreads out on average overall, even if we locally are able to decrease it. Now, let's do some calculations with this or just some concept things. So first, do some practice with these and I'll go over them in just a minute. So the first one is, well, unfortunately, I've used the same example. So we have NaCl solid. We already said this one. This one increases entropy because we're going from the solid to the aqueous form. Now here it's not written as a chemical formula, but we say water freezes to form ice. So that would suggest we had liquid water and we froze it so it formed solid water. Well, this is going to cause a decrease in entropy. So the answer is no, it doesn't increase. Now in our third example, here we have two gas molecules and on the right side we have three. So this is going to increase with increasing molecule number. Number of molecules. Now let's also look at this next question of what is going to be the entropy change for the reaction 2Na solid plus chlorine gas goes to form 2NaCl solid. So for these, if I want to provide it for you, if you're doing it on a test, for example, or you're taking someone else's test and you have to look these up, you'll probably have a table somewhere. Or if you're doing homework, you'll have a table. I have a table in my own notes. There's also a table usually in your text where you can look up the values for the entropy for each of these things. And what we find is that our delta S overall for our reaction is going to be the sum, that's a really badly written sum, of all of our values for our products minus the sum of all the values for our reactants. And what we'll also do is we usually put an N out here, and that represents the fact that we have to account for how many moles there are of each when doing this calculation. So first for our products, we only have a product, NaCl solid, and there's two of them. So this one, we're going to have 2 times our 72.1 joules per mole Kelvin. Then we're going to subtract from it all the reactants, which I'm going to add all the reactants together first and subtract them. So first we have sodium. We have 2 of those, and they have a value of 51.3 joules per mole Kelvin. And then we also have 1 chlorine, and that 1 chlorine has a value of 223.1 joules per mole Kelvin. So if I sum everybody up, I'm going to get 144.2 joules per mole Kelvin for the products minus, then we have all the reactants, and those will give me 325.7 joules per mole Kelvin. So if I were to combine these, and there's an L on mole, I left those out, we're going to get negative 181.5 joules per mole Kelvin. So those are some of the more straightforward calculations you can do with entropy, as well as some of the concepts to go over related to our entropy discussion in class.